So I was explaining the first part of the effective one-body method, which was this resummation of the dynamics. And I want to emphasize two things. So we start with a post-Newtonian expanded dynamics, which is quite complicated and which is useless in the sense that if you try to predict what is, for instance, the last stable orbit from the Newtonian approximation, the first 1PN, the second 1PN, you get answers which do not converge anywhere, which jump around, and you don't know what would be the good answer. And also, technically, it is quite complicated. There are enormous simplifications in the effective one-body representation of the dynamics. The first reason is that it uses only gauge invariant constructs. That is to say, these objects depend on the phase space coordinates you use for the Hamiltonian. Okay? I can change them at will. Once you go to a Delaunay Hamiltonian, which is expressing the Hamiltonian as a function of the action variables, everything is gauge invariant. It does not depend on coordinate system, anything. It is, that's what I had represented. It's like the quantum energy level. Chuk, 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 chuk. So this is physics. Now, when you go, I explain in detail how you do things at 1PN. When you go at higher PN, part of the simplification is that you first get the fact that the link between the effective energy, now I will put C equal 1, sorry, not 0, 1, you find that the result you obtained at 1PN is actually exact at all PN orders, okay? And this was explicitly proven to high orders. So the first element is there is a link between the real energy of the system and the energy of the effective problem, which is given by this equation once for all, which is saying the effective energy is Mandelstam invariant, S is linear in Mandelstam invariant.
Effective binding, there is something missing.
This is real.
No. Yes, one of the two is wrong. It's the real, which is not binding, sorry. This is the full real, including mc square. So this thing, the square of the real energy is Mandelstam invariant for the scattering problem. It's the mc square plus binding energy square. Okay, so you have this result that you find by calculation. Then what you find is the dynamics, this dynamics is encoded in two functions plus, in three functions. Let me define the quantity. All these expressions are in terms of gm over c square r, okay? So I don't want to write gm over c square r. Gm over r is the Newtonian potential. So gm, where m is the sum of the two masses, c square r, where r is the EUB radius, you call it small u, like the Newtonian potential capital U. It's a dimensionless quantity. Now, Schwarzschild is 1 minus 2u for g0, 0, okay? And in EOB, what you find, I introduced the function b, but it's convenient, as we know that in Schwarzschild, the product a times b is 1, because you remember the Schwarzschild metric. You introduce the function, the product ab, you call it d, and you also introduce the inverse of d that you call d bar. Okay, it's just a notation to encode things in a simpler way. Now I have the function a and the function d bar. These, as I explained, are deformations of Schwarzschild. That is to say, when u is, these are functions of u and nu. When nu, the symmetric mass ratio defined up there, is zero, I must have this. This is Schwarzschild. And the mass shell condition is always what I have written, mu square plus g mu nu, it was written somewhere, the mass shell condition for the effective problem here, okay? Now, in general, you find, this was found by Jarnowski, Schaeffer, and myself at 3PN in 2000, you need to modify the mass shell condition, mu square plus p square, by higher order in p that you expect in any effective theory. You have mu square plus p square plus p4 plus things like that. And you call all the higher order, you call them q. Okay, This is just a name that you need a deformation of the mass shell condition. So Q, and let me define Q over mu square, which is dimensionless. Okay. Now at 1 PN, as I said, at 1 PN you don't need to add anything. 1 PN would be terms of order u square here, and terms of order u here. Okay. Actually, these terms are absent. Okay, it's 0 times u. This is 0 times u square. This was the big simplification I was saying. At 1 PN, I am Schwarzschild, and mu square is just mu square. Okay. At 2 PN, 2 PN means this beast. Okay, here, the full 2 PN dynamics is equivalent to adding here a 2 new u cube. And here, a 6 nu u square, okay? And here, nothing. So you see, these two coefficients, 2 nu, 6 nu, is equivalent to all those things. This is a big simplification. At 3 PN, you find that you just need to add a coefficient here. But remember, at 3 PN, they were pi square things. Okay, and the pi square are physical. They will remain. So the coefficient that appear at 3 PN will contain pi square, and you find that everything is contained in 94 over 3 minus 41 over 32 pi square, nu u4, and then a coefficient here, which is plus 52 minus 6 nu, nu u cube. And here you need here to add 2 times 4 minus 3 nu, nu u square, PR over mu to the fourth, a term quartic in PR. Okay. So the full, these three coefficients, this number, and this number, is equivalent to this full 3 PN thing. Okay. It's a big simplification, which allows a technical simplification at this stage. And then we have computed at the next order, where there is an extra term and there is a logarithm appearing at the next term. But let me discuss at 3 PN. So this is 3 PN. This is 2 PN. And this goes diagonally. 3 PN u4 means 3 PN u cube here, etc. One thing. This formula, you use the effective one-body to compute the dynamics. The dynamics I just erased is given by an Hamiltonian dynamics with the real Hamiltonian plus a radiation reaction force. The real Hamiltonian is what? It is this quantity as a function of phase space variable. So I need to solve this thing in terms of this. Okay? Therefore, I will get that this, because it is a square, will be a square root. When you compute things, you find that the real Hamiltonian in EUB as a function of the phase space coordinates of EUB is equal to capital M times square root, because I have a square root to solve for this. And the square root is 1 plus 2 nu minus 1 plus this effective energy. But the effective energy satisfies a quadratic condition also. E square minus P square equal mu square, essentially. And therefore, the effective energy is a square root itself. Therefore, here I have a second square root, which is square root of the function A of R prime, 1 plus P square plus AD bar minus 1 NP prime square plus Z3, where Z3 is this coefficient, nu times GM over R prime to the, sorry, n prime p prime 4 divided by r prime square. Okay? This square root goes to here, this square root goes to here. So here you already see a big resummation in the sense that the Hamiltonian is written as square root of a square root. If I start expanding the square root, I will generate many terms like p square, p4, p6, which are indeed part of these terms here, but massage in a new way. So it is part of the good thing. But now, what are the circular orbits? If I compute because I want to describe a sequence of circular orbits before being fully non-adiabatic, just to have an idea. Because I have replaced, so I am, yeah, I should say, nu is a deformation parameter. The effective one-body method is never assuming that nu is a small parameter. One is not expanding, assuming nu is small, one-fourth is small. No, one-fourth is one, okay, is order one. Only if nu is 10 minus 5, you can say it is small, okay? But what is assumed is that we have a continuous deformation between a small particle going around a big black hole to the case where you have two equal mass black holes, that the relative dynamics is described by an effective metric, which when you see there is nu in factor of every term here, nu square, when nu goes to zero, I go back to Schwarzschild. This is the idea. But now I have deformed continuously Schwarzschild. If you look at the effective potential for circular orbits, you do the same thing as in Schwarzschild, but the difference is that M1 minus 2M over R is replaced by the function A. It's a very simple calculation. You take any textbook you like on general relativity, for instance, the book of Madame Choquet, the recent book, you will find effective potential for circular orbits, and you replace the Schwarzschild A function by this. But then you have a surprise, in the sense that if you look at this thing, so let us plot as a function of R, the effective one body, this effective potential, which is the function A of R times 1 plus angular momentum square over R square, where I have this function. If I do it at, this is 2pn, remember that at the 1pn approximation, I have no modification. So what is this function? At the 1pn approximation, this is 1 minus 2m over R by 1 plus L square over R square. So let me plot, sorry. Before plotting this, let me take this thing without this factor, okay? I will add this factor, okay? Let me plot the function A over R, just to see. At the 1pn approximation, I have 1 minus 2m over R, which is a function like that. This is the Schwarzschild thing, which is zero at 2m, okay? If you compute it at, this is at Newtonian, but it is also at 1pn, okay? At 2pn, I have this extra term. But this extra term, you see, it is 2 nu. Nu is 1/4 at the maximum. If I am at near u equal 2, u to the cube is 1 over 2 to the cube. It's 1 over 8, 1/4, 1 over 32. It's not a big deal, okay? And then when you compute things at 2pn, you find that you have a function which is like that at 2pn. At 3pn, I have this extra term. And that was the surprise at the time, which is that this coefficient here is numerically large, is 18 point something. And then when you compute the 3pn expanded potential, this potential, remember, 1 minus 2m over r is essentially the gravitational potential, is the relativistic gravitational potential, the Newtonian attraction minus m over r with the relativistic thing. At 3pn, if you put this term, you find something which is like that, okay? Because all these are positive, this coefficient is positive, this coefficient is positive, so it is above the thing. And then you find that you don't have, like here, something which crosses zero. At this stage, and this is what we said with Yarnowski and Schaefer in 2000, we said, no, there is something not good here. We want continuity between the Schwarzschild case and the Schwarzschild. In the Schwarzschild case, we have a function which has an horizon, because this thing, 2m, is where g00 is zero, is the horizon. And this rules, the existence of an horizon is what determines the existence of a last stable orbit, of et cetera, okay? So let's impose that there is an horizon. But to do that, we just said we replace A3PN, given by this, by the Padé, the simplest Padé approximant, which will have an horizon. And you say, I want a Padé of the form 1 plus N1U over 1 plus D1U plus D2U square plus D3U cube. That is to say, a pade 1-3 with one power U up and three powers down to represent a polynomial of fourth order in U. It's a unique definition. Given this, there is a unique pade. And we said this will be the good EUB thing. Now, if you plot this pade, you find that it is the 3PN pade. You see, it's very close to this here, but it avoids this thing, which is the bad aspect of the Taylor expansion that some term become large. Okay, so now at 3PN, you have something like that. And up to very recently, this was, in a sense, the best analytical representation. First, let us mention that the fact that all those things are on the left above means that in the gravitational attraction between two masses, you correct the usual Schwarzschild 1 over r by extra term, which make it less attractive in the following sense. This term is minus 2m over r. It is an attractive potential. But you add to minus 2m over r plus 2m over r squared plus 2m over r cubed. So it means the extra forces due to the nonlinearity of gravity are repulsive, in a sense that they diminish the main attractive thing. So it's a prediction of EUB. And now, with this thing, if I add this term, if the angular momentum is non-zero, the curve, so I start now with this curve, and now I add the centrifugal potential, which means that I must multiply this by this term. But then it gives me curves of the following type. They will be zero always at this point because it is a product. And then I will have things like that, okay? If the angular momentum is high, I will have a centrifugal barrier. I will have a circular orbit, stable circular orbit here. And because of the horizon, I have if I diminish the value of L, if L becomes smaller, I will go to a regime which is like that. And then if L goes even smaller, I will have this thing. There will be an inflection point. And therefore, at this location, this is the location of the last circular orbit. Where I have these two objects that lose angular momentum. And when the angular momentum gets to a value such like that, I have a last stable orbit. And beyond that, the thing will, like people said in the past, plunge, in the sense that, like the ground falling under your feet, something happens, okay? Now one can analytically compute everything, and very simply, I mean, in Mathematica, you know, it takes 3 minutes to compute this, okay? I mean, it took years to compute this, but once you know the EUB thing, in 3 minutes you compute what is the location of the last stable orbit, and you find that the gravitational wave frequency, at just to have now an idea, let's put numbers. I said EOB predicts waves when the two black holes get near. There is a moment where the two things will plunge together, and after that, as we will see, it's fast. They will merge fast. So it's an indication at which frequency you will see gravitational waves from merging black holes. Because up to now, in Newtonian physics, you have no scales. You don't know at which scale something will happen. Now you have a scale. As I said, because of the quadrupole formula, the gravitational wave frequency is twice the orbital frequency. By the way, frequency means that frequency in Hertz, okay. Omega is the circular frequency. F is the frequency in Hertz, so there is a factor 2 pi. Omega equals 2 pi nu, but Americans denote frequency by F, and nu is used for something else, so it's nice to say F is frequency, okay? This you can analytically compute, and then you find that this is 1.29, okay. You find, because of nu, when nu equal 1/4, let me say that. When nu equal 1/4, this frequency is 1 over 6 to the 3/2, where 6 is the 6 GM of the last stable orbit, okay. It's Kepler's law at radius 6. With additional decorating factor, which is gm over c cube, and a pi, which is this pi here. Now, the correction due to EUB, the fact that I have all those extra terms, you know that the push this, it pushes the last the frequency at the last orbit up by 30%, which is not at all negligible in this business. Okay.
The relative percentage is 30%. It's 2 PN.
It's 3 PN here. Pas des rhizomes 3 PN.
But suppose that you don't know 3 PN and you stop at 2 PN.
At 2 PN, it is smaller. Okay. It is, I forgot the number, it's what we use with Alessandra. In our original paper, we had only 2 PN, and then we were going less high in frequency, okay? But if you just update it a year after, in fact, the same year, we computed with Yaranovsky-Schaeffer the 3 PN. Now, if you put numbers, to compute numbers, you use this formula. Gm sun is 5 microseconds, okay? And therefore, I can convert this, you know, 6 to the 3/2 and thing like that in hertz. And then you find that this is 5,700 hertz divided by m in solar mass units, hertz. Okay? For instance, let's assume that I have two masses, 65, that the sum of the two masses is 65 solar mass. Okay? This gives 87.7 hertz. So, for instance, this thing predicts that the last stable orbit, before the merger, you reach nearly 90 hertz. When, with Alessandro yesterday, we checked on the full UBNR, which I will explain, that is to say, when you include more information coming both from analytical calculation and from numerical relativity, actually it moves this curve a little bit more. And then it has a certain shape here, but it's not important. So it moves it a little bit more. And then the frequency goes even higher. In that case, that is to say EOBNR, that I will discuss, gives 97.67 hertz. So from 90 to nearly 100 hertz.
With respect to the time of the observer.
Yeah, this is in the source, yeah. Not of the observer. It's not our time. There is a redshift factor. Yeah, because I'm not saying where it is in the universe, OK? This is intrinsic frequency if I am there.
Oh, okay. Thibault?
Yes.
Sorry, why is the Palais approximation of the function A2PN, you replace the A2PN or 3PN, sorry, the diverging one by one which had an horizon, right? By using this Palais.
The 3PN, yes.
Yes, by using this Palais approximation. So why is that a good procedure?
How did you fix the value of the horizon?
Okay, so this is the same question. When we, this was a prediction, okay? In 2000, we said we want something continuous, and then it fixes the padé you want, because if you say padé, you can try all the padés, okay? There are 4 choices. And then you find that only one has the nice property, so you say it's the best. So now padé is unique, that is to say, I give you this expansion. There is a unique representation in this form whose pn expansion is equal to this. It's a Padé has proven this in it's trivial to show. You have as many equations as unknowns. Okay.
But why is Padé a good one? Is there?
No, I mean at this stage, nobody knew whether. I mean, nobody took it seriously.
A guess.
I mean, it's more than a guess. I mean, it's not, you know, blah. We had before. No, let me. Yeah, let me insist on this, because there is a paper by some of our American friends, students of Kip Thorne. I mean, one of the authors is Tucholsky. And in this paper, they said on the inefficiency of using Padé for this thing. Okay, that, I remember this paper, okay? And we had used Padé before, and at the time, there was no completely logical justification, except the intuition that EOB had to be in continuity with things, okay? Then, at this stage, this was 5 years before numerical relativity. When numerical relativity came online, they have shown that, indeed, this is a very good approximation of the thing. This is now what I will describe. But I need now to describe the other part of the dynamics, which is the radiation reaction. So I won't write it again. Remember that you write the equations of motion as conservative Hamiltonian equation plus the radiation reaction. And I said the radiation reaction has to be resummed in some way because at merger it's very bad, okay? You cannot trust at all. The first thing we did at the time, was to reuse the idea I explained of with Iyer and Satya Prakash, which is again to use Paderi summation. Okay? And at the beginning with Alessandro, this is what we used. Okay? And actually, this was good enough to show to show several things. So in the paper of 2000, we use a Paderi summation of the flux, which defines a Paderi summation of the radiation reaction on the right-hand side. And as we were working at 2pn, we did not need any Paderi summation because we could use the 2pn is here and does not need. If you Paderi it, you get the same thing. It's a kind of, it's a very small difference to Paderi it or not. So it shows some consistency of doing Paderi. But then what did it predict? It predicts that when these two objects get closer and closer, they will reach a moment like that, where when the frequency reaches something like that, the two things will want to fall. Okay. And people at the time called that the plunge, as if you know, the two things were going like that and then stopped and plunged. But actually, we found this was wrong. What happens is when what happens is the following. When you are here and then at the next step you are like this, you don't have a radial velocity. The radial momentum is very small at this stage. So instead of suddenly plunging like that, you continue going around because the angular momentum is still large and you have a little bit of radial momentum. So what happens is that you have an in spiral which gets a little bit more in spiraling in. So you reach the last stable orbit here, and then the plunge is also quasi in spiral. But then what happens? Because you need, so the first prediction was that there was a blurred transition in a sense that the plunge is the smooth continuation of the in spiral. And in the signal, in fact, you don't see where is the plunge because the signal is still quasi sinusoidal, okay. But, and then you could prove that during the plunge, the ratio of the radial momentum square and divided by B of R and the longitudinal momentum, P phi square over R square, was always significantly smaller than one. It was quite small even at the last stable orbit, which was showing you were quasi-adiabatic, but not quite because there were still effects. Because yes, what the point I want to say is the adiabatic approximation consists in saying that the point is sitting at the minimum of the thing. But actually this is wrong because there is a radiation reaction which pushes it, finally wants to push it inwards, and therefore the thing is always displaced. It is always moving, okay? It's never really adiabatic.
So it's a radiation reaction force which changes L?
No. L changes, but you have equation, yes, okay. You solve the following equations. R dot equal dh by dpr, pr dot equal minus dh by dr, and p phi dot equal f of phi. You prove by some reasoning that you don't need a radial force fr, okay. What I'm saying is the adiabatic approximation says, let's take a minimum of h where r dot is zero and pr dot is zero. This is not true. There is a pr dot and a pr which is non-zero all the time, but small. And this is driving the system. P phi is diminishing, but it's a function of r also in p phi. So you need a coupled system. You solve the coupled system numerically now, but you have the analytic equation. At the time, so in 2000 with Alessandra, we gave the first estimate of the complete waveform. It's published from in spiral to ring down. We also estimated the spin of the final black hole after the merging. At the time, we were using 2pn and a rough ring down attachment that I will describe. And then we predicted that the spin of the final black hole is 0.79, while modern numerical relativity shows it is 0.7, 0.69. Okay? And the black hole which has been found has a spin of order 0.7 indeed. So we were 14% off, but it's not too bad for something which was just 2pn, resum 2pn. Okay? At the time, some of our colleagues in the school of Kipthorne, that is to say, in a paper of Brady, Creighton, and Thorne, they were saying that there will be a gap between two things. Post-Newtonian methods, they had in mind, that was before these calculations, okay? So they did not even know that, but they knew something like that would be true. They said, you cannot rely on this, which is true. And therefore, you can compute the gravitational waves only up to some stage, because in the latent spiral, this expansion becomes very bad. And when you form a final black hole, a Kerr black hole, it will ring down with the quasi-normal modes first discovered by Visveshvara in 1970. So at the end, you know that the thing will decay exponentially with some frequency. And the main point of their thing was to say there is a big gap, because this is like 12m, and this is the late ring down, and then you don't know. You absolutely need numerical relativity. At the time, we said, and they said that there were at least 8 orbits unknown there. Okay. Our aim with Alessandra was to propose EOB as a way of closing this gap, as saying, okay, let's resum everything. We resum the dynamics, we trust EOB at least qualitatively and semi-quantitatively, and then we can compute now the full waveform. But in order to compute the full waveform, we need something more. We need to know within the formalism at which point we will say, because now I am doing the EOB, the waveform computation. So during a long in-spiral, you describe the system as I described by a skeletonized version, which means the two black holes are replaced by two point masses. And they emit gravitational waves, they interact in an EOB resummed way. They go around, they go closer and closer. But at some point, you want to say these two black holes will merge and will form one black hole. And there we made an assumption, which at the time was a guess, saying we can, within the EOB formalism, determine at which moment there is a transition between two black holes and the moment where these two black holes will merge and become one deformed black hole that will rotate in a bar mode, and that this merge thing will immediately be representable as a sum of quasi-normal modes. This was the assumption of the EOB formalism, and this is the way we computed in 2000 the first waveform, which was obtained by this thing. In the EOB formalism, you determine a moment of merger that you compute analytically. You say before this moment, the thing is described by two separate black holes that emit by quadrupole plus higher multipoles. You resum everything. So it computes this phase evolution. You study the dynamics using this. And at the merger, the idea was to say after merger, the signal will be a sum of several quasi-normal modes. You need, it's not true to say one quasi-normal mode is enough, although in our initial papers we said, for simplicity, let's put one. Later we said, evidently, we need to put more. But the idea is, if you know the function, you see, the idea looks trivial, but actually it is predictive. If you have a function, and you know not only the value of the function, but the value of its first derivative and second derivative, you can match this function to a sum of quasi-normal modes, which means sum of Cn exponential minus alpha n t, where the alpha n are complex numbers with positive real part. So they have the form, if you want, alpha n plus plus I omega n qnm. So this part is an oscillatory part, and this part is a damped part. You know these things because you can compute the final mass. You can compute during the EOB also what is the energy lost during the merger. Therefore, you know what is the energy of the final black hole and the spin of the final black hole. Therefore, you can compute these things from M1 and M2. You know this, you don't know this, but if you put, let's say, three coefficients, C1, C2, C3, and if you impose that this function is continuous, first derivative continuous, second derivative continuous, it gives you three equations for three unknowns. So you predict these things from the matching that they are a smooth continuation. It looks like a totally bold thing, but it works finally. So we are going to see in what sense it works.
So you needed only three because of...
No, three is... okay. In the origin, it's an example. In the first paper, we gave the idea and we gave one thing. Okay, but it was just to show we could, in principle, compute the full thing. But if you do this, that is to say, the UB waveform is finally made by joining two things. One thing, which is the in-spiral motion, non-adiabatic, up to some moment that I will define now of merger, which defines this thing. And then you attach a QNM ringing thing in a certain way. If you look now at what it means for the gravitational wave frequency, or let's say, let me put orbital frequency. And when I don't have an orbital motion but the gravitational waves, I mean with this half the gravitational wave circular frequency. If you compute in EOB what is the orbital frequency as a function of time, you find a function which grows and which has a sharp maximum somewhere. Okay. When you compute in EOB, you find that formally the orbital frequency ceases to increase at some moment. Now, what are the various points here? There is a point here which corresponds to the last stable orbit. And if you put numbers, you find that omega LSO multiplied by m, which is a dimensionless number, is equal at, for instance, at 2pn, it is 0.0734. At 3pn, it is 0.088. Okay? We will compare this. This 88 is what I was giving here. So it gives like 90 hertz for 60 solar mass. And then there is this maximum. Now, by looking at the EOB, you find that this maximum happens when the relative particle, the effective particle in its plunge, is crossing the light ring. Because before crossing the horizon, there is another remarkable thing, which is that if you consider, for instance, if you consider the function a over r square, which is the coefficient of l square, okay? As you know from textbooks, if you formally consider the motion of a photon in a relativistic particle, in a ultra-relativistic particle in a spherically symmetric metric, you find that the effective potential, yeah, because here there was mu square, if you want. Okay. The first term, one, was mu square. Okay. If you take a massless particle, like a photon, mu square is zero. And now the effective potential becomes A divided by R square. And then this effective potential has a certain shape, because now the function A over R square is something which... Yes, so let me, I'm used to the, so at infinity it is 1 over r square, then it has a maximum, then it is 0 at the horizon, okay? In Schwarzschild, it is 0 at 2m, and it is maximum at 3m, okay? Which is the last, it's the photon orbit, okay? In EOB, you say there is a light ring, which is not equal, which is this thing, but it is light ring, and this is horizon, so it defines NR. This R is such that this is the maximum frequency from the orbital thing. This signal has a frequency given by the first quasi-normal mode. Now, from the studies of Vishveshwara, Bill Press, others, you find that the frequency of the first quasi-normal mode is here. Is like a factor 2 up from this. And therefore, because of this, if you interpolate this function in a smooth way by adding many quasi-normal, what happens is that the EOB frequency will be something like that. At the end, the EOB matching is saying this part is the in-spiral, this is the last stable orbit, there is merger, and then I will go to the first quasi-normal mode, okay? But you define the merger by this light ring. Okay, so it makes a prediction. Now, what is the value of the light ring frequency? Here I gave the value of the gravitational wave frequency at the last stable orbit. If you, let me put this up.
So it's when it reaches the light ring, it really plunges in a sense.
That it?
Yeah. Really plunges.
So
at article 3M.
One is saying, but this was a decision, okay, which was not
because the particle is going almost at the speed of light.
But you know, it is at 40% of the speed of light at the LSO. It is so one cannot say it's nearly the speed of light because is it 57%? Okay. In the formalism, it's not that you are saying roughly it will be there. You are saying, I want to push the formalism to the maximum to make a prediction. Certainly, I cannot go beyond this point. So let's be bold and say, okay, I will trust the formalism up to the absolute thing where it makes no sense beyond. And then I say the two things are so close that at this point I will guess that the two things will, the two black holes will merge, like two soap bubbles, like. And the idea was that the transition is so fast that it will be nearly, that I can do continuity. Okay. And this is what has been checked to be true by numerical relativity simulation 5 years later. Okay. I don't know if we'll have the time to show you a movie to show this explicit movie. Okay, so let me give also further numbers. You find that the gravitational wave frequency for the L equal 2, M equal 2 mode at merger in computed in EOB NR, which I will explain, is a version of EOB where now you use comparison to numerical relativity to go beyond the 3PN and analytical thing. But finally, it's still close to the 3PN. It's not, you know, factor two, whatever, is just like a few percent adjustment. You find that this is 0.377. And therefore, if I define formally the orbital frequency at merger, this is the 0.19 I was quoting before, which gave the 57 of the velocity of light. But it, now if I compute things, this is saying that in EOB, the merger frequency, which is this point along the thing, is, you can compute it, this is 0.19 divided by pi gm over c cubed. You use this numerical formula, and then you find that this is 12,182, don't trust all digits, hertz, divided by m in solar mass. And you should not believe that because you see 12,000 hertz, we are in the 10 kilohertz thing, because if you put 65 solar mass here, you find that this is 187.4 hertz, M65 solar mass divided by M.
Why do you give 4 digits?
It's just because when you put zero, sometimes you don't see well. Okay. Now, let me discuss, because I will need this in the... So let me put this here, 187.4. Hertz divided by m in units of 65 now solar mass. Okay, just 65 is taken from the data, but it's just a scaling here.
In fact, it's 65.2232.
No, it's 65 plus or minus 4. So I mean, okay. Let me discuss measurability because now I want to say what has been measured, how it is measured, why is an analytical formalism useful for measurements. And how this type of prediction, which was the first one we made, is used really in the data, not only as saying, ah, maybe it's like that, but to extract things from the data. For this, I need to recall the basic work of Norbert Wiener about optimal filtering. So what are we talking about? We have an observation, we have the output of the interferometers is something which oscillates in time. The difference delta L, essentially, you know, delta L over L of the two arms of the interferometer as a function of time. This thing is the sum of two things. It is the sum of the signal, H, which is, you know, the TT wave, gravitational wave, really. I am not joking here. I mean, this is a dimensionless thing. We are saying there is a 10 minus 21. So we have a wave like that, which has an amplitude, really, 10 minus 21, it's a dimensionless quantity, which makes the thing move a little bit. And then, actually, most of the time, I just have noise, you know? And the noise is something which is colored noise, okay? Colored noise means that it is not a white noise. It is, yes, it is, it has correlations in time, okay? And I will define things. Now, the correlation in times, n of t1, n of t2, statistical average, is a certain function of t1 minus t2. The Fourier transform of this, as a, the Fourier transform, the measure of the Fourier transform, is called the noise, okay, Sn. So, nt1, nt2, okay, is integral of d, okay, so now here I have, in principle, to be careful, df 2 pi f t Sn of Sn of f, okay? Yes, I think this formula is correct even with the factors too. So it defines the noise Sn, the noise spectral density in the interferometer. Now, in order to extract this thing, except for sufficiently strong signals, and in the paper, because one has already, if you don't filter the data, you don't see the signal, okay? In the discovery paper, they have already filtered the data so you can see that there is a signal, because the signal was strong enough, and with a small filtering, you could see things. If you do no filtering, it is lost in the noise. How do you extract it from the noise? This is the idea of Norbert Wiener, that you should do a scalar product between what you observe and the expected signal, that is to say, in order to extract a signal from the noise, it's like extracting a needle from a haystack. You need to know the shape, color, and precise structure of the needle, and then you can find it because your eye is adapted to it. Mathematically, you define a scalar product. You define a Hilbert space structure on the space of real function. If I have two functions of time, okay, you define its scalar product, the Wiener scalar product, as the integral df divided by the inverse, so it's the inverse noise. Tilde means the Fourier transform, h tilde 1 f, h tilde 2 complex conjugate f. For real function, it's a real object. And now, what you do is, when you have an observed signal, you make the scalar product with the expected signal as a function of some parameters. So, for instance here, this signal depends on m, the total mass, and the mass ratio. When you add spin, it depends on 8 parameters. So you have a signal which you know analytically, which is a function of time, which depends on 8 parameters. You take its Fourier transform, you time shift it also to say at which time it starts and things like that. You add an arbitrary phase because there is a phase projection, and then you make this scalar product, and then you look for which value of lambda this thing is maximum. Most of the time, this thing is random and is as a function of lambda and is within the one sigma of its own random noise. To compute a good thing, in fact, it's good to divide it by the norm, the square root of this h lambda, so h lambda is a unit vector in a Hilbert space. And then this thing is the sum of two terms, because observational is sum of h plus n. So I have this, h over h lambda divided by square root of h lambda, plus n h lambda divided by square root of h lambda. Now, the fact that you have put here the inverse noise, here the noise, means that this thing is a random variable, which, if the noise is Gaussian, is a random Gaussian variable with sigma square, with the variance 1. You just define this way. So here, you have something random, which is plus or minus 1. And therefore, you need this thing to be much higher than 1 to be able to say, if you get this thing with something much higher than 1, you know that you have detected something. That's the idea.
How do you know Sn?
OK. Sn, you study your detector luckily, there are very few gravitational waves, or we'll see if there are, which means that the random things that you see most of the time is due to the noise, not to a background of gravitational waves. If there is a background of gravitational waves, anyway, you introduce it in the noise. You say, I cannot distinguish it from the laser noise and things like that. But you measure it experimentally. Okay. We will see what is its value. And then you define the signal-to-noise ratio square, SNR square, also called rho square, is equal, actually, to the square of this, because this is 1, okay, in RMS sense. So the rest is rho square, okay? And then, so this thing is the scalar product h by h lambda square divided by h lambda. So the theorem of Wiener is that taking a filter which is and this scalar product is the most accurate representation is the best way of extracting a signal from the noise. You need to do a convolution weighted by the inverse noise of the output of the detector with what you expect. And then this is the best statistic to know when you have a signal. Okay, this is a theorem of Wiener. And therefore, at the end, if you use as optimal filter h lambda equal to h, that is to say, if you have been able to compute the signal to be exactly the signal, you are not sure in advance. For instance, the theory of gravity could be different from GR and what you compute now. Okay, but you will test this later. Okay, if h lambda is equal to h, you find that rho square optimal, the optimal is equal simply, because now you have hh squared divided by h, so you have hh. So the final result of Wiener is that the optimal signal to noise ratio is just the square of the h computed with this, which means what? This thing is the integral df, by the definition, divided, so it is the Fourier transform square divided by the noise. But this thing has, for a physicist, something inconvenient, which I don't know why experimentalists always quote this. Like, for instance, they say, here is the spectral density of our detector. Be careful, it's written 10 minus 23. Don't conclude that you can measure a gravitational wave 10 minus 23, because this is per root hertz. Per root hertz means that if you want something which has the dimension of what you measure, you just multiply Sn by f. Now it becomes a strain, dimensionless strain. If I multiply by f, I need to multiply also this by f, okay? But let also, the Fourier transform also is a bad object, because the Fourier transform is an integral of something dimensionless times d t. So it has dimension of inverse hertz. Therefore, if you want an object which is a good Fourier transform with the dimension you expect, I need to multiply also the Fourier transform by f. But then I need an extra f here. But this is good, because now the measure is df over f, is dimensionless. It is the logarithmic measure. So if I plot things in log of f, the area I see is what you see is what you get. So everything is dimensionless. And then in this form, I have d log of f. This thing you can call the signal, f squared. And this thing you can call the noise, f squared. That is, in this form, it's just a rewriting of Wiener's result. But you have really the ratio of the signal in the units you like, square divided by the noise in strain, square, integrated over an octave in frequency. You know, like in cosmology, you always work in octave in frequency. This is better. And this you can compute. You can compute analytically to some extent because of the following thing. The signal is like that. This is an oscillatory signal. If I want to compute its Fourier transform, I need to compute a function which is, let's say, h of t equal an amplitude a of t times a cosine of a phase, where the phase is this thing. I want to compute the Fourier transform. But there is a very good approximation, which is the stationary phase approximation. When I compute an integral Fourier transform is the integral of something exponential I phi of t, I have a of t, and then I have exponential minus 2 pi I f t dt. But this is an oscillatory integral. I know the oscillatory integral is dominated by the saddle point, the point of the stationary phase, okay? So you can compute it analytically. And this approximation is very good. It's really good. It's not now, you know, a 10% approximation. It's valid to a part in 10 to the 3 most of the time. So anyway, it gives a simple way of computing. This way, you can compute h tilde of f. And then you find, for instance, it is a t divided by square root of f dot, where f is the frequency. So the frequency is 2 pi f equal phi dot. The derivative of the phase is the frequency. The frequency is a function of time. There is a time at which this frequency is equal to the frequency of the Fourier transform. It's a Legendre transform, finally. So given a frequency, I compute a time. I compute all this at time t, and then it defines the formula. Okay, so I can compute things this way. And then you find that this formula can be written. So this is explained in many places, but in particular in a paper of mine with Iyer and Satya Prakash in 2000. And then you find also that the signal HSF is equal, square, is equal to the square of the amplitude, as you expect, because but the square of the amplitude is multiplied by a very important factor, which is the number of useful cycles contributing around frequency f to the signal. This n of f is defined, or n, this is the time-dependent frequency, is the dimensionless number f divided by f dot, df by dt. This is a dimensionless number. It says that if the frequency is varying slowly, so that I have a quasi, you know, sine wave, I should count many cycles. They help because I am a sine during many cycles. So it increases the effective measurability of the signal by this quantity, which is the Q factor of the wave. And anyway, it's a calculation. So you can compute, now you can compute everything with the quadrupole approximation, for instance. Everything I say you can compute exactly, numerically, by the Fourier transform, or you can compute analytically in EUB with some numerical, or you can do the rough thing, which is to say I use the quadrupole Einstein formula and I compute everything by hand just to see. It's not very accurate, but it gives the main idea. When you do that, you find a very simple result. The quadrupole formula says, because at the end, you get most of the numbers, you know, by hand. Quadrupole formula says that the amplitude of the gravitational waves is the second derivative of the quadrupole moment. The quadrupole moment is m position. If I take two derivatives, I will have m velocity plus an extra term, but which is of the same order of magnitude, which means the quadrupole is second derivative is proportional to velocity square. Therefore, the amplitude is velocity square. Remember that velocity was defined by Mr. Johannes Kepler, thank you, as gm, the orbital frequency, 1/3, okay? C equal 1 here, okay? So from the frequency, the orbital frequency, which in terms of the gravitational wave frequency, it would be pi gm f, because I have a factor 2 and 2 pi divided by 2, 1/3. So I can compute v, the what I call velocity, as a function of the gravitational wave frequency. This is a function of frequency. I use this. And now n of f is what? Is the number of useful cycles before the thing changes a lot. But what is this? We know since Einstein that the radiation reaction, in fact, maybe not Einstein, but anyway, is V over C5, okay. This is why, for instance, this is at 2.5 pn. At 2.5 pn, you have a correction of order V over C5. This is radiation damping. Radiation damping in GR is an effect at the fifth order in V over C. But this is saying that the time it takes for the orbit to realize it is going to change because of radiation damping is the inverse of this. And then, therefore, the useful cycle is C over V to the 5. That's all, with a numerical coefficient. When you put these two things together in this formula, you find that you can compute everything at the quadrupole approximation, which is not good for, but still, which gives an idea. It's 1 over 15 pi, g square root of m1, m2, the geometric average of the two masses, divided by c squared, the distance at which the binary is. If the binary is very far, the signal goes down like 1 over r. Here I'm computing the signal to noise ratio square, okay? And now I have integral of d log of f. By the way, I should say, sometimes I'm using integrals from minus infinity to plus infinity. Sometimes you fold it back on 0 to plus infinity, so there is a factor 2 here, factor 4 here, but here everything is included. Times 1 over vf. Yes, 1 over vf, simply because I have the square of this. And I said v, the amplitude is v square, quadrupole. V square square is v4. But I must divide by v5. So I get v4 over v5 is 1 over v. So I get 1 over v. And then I have the noise. And then what? This is the signal that I can compute up to the moment where the signal changes abruptly and goes to zero. If we knew nothing, we could say the signal goes like up to merger. And after merger, in rough approximation, I could say I have a theta function, which is to say for frequencies above merger, it goes to zero, just to compute numbers. Okay. And if you do that, and I will show, I will stop now for 15 minutes, but I will just show the kind of thing I'm talking about here. Yes, maybe I can use this, because I don't need this anymore. As a function of log of f, ln means natural log, but in practice we will use base 10 log, just to other thing. What is this thing? So you see, there is a factor in front. Evidently, if the thing is more massive, the signal is larger. If the thing is at a smaller distance, the signal is larger. So this is nature that gives us this. That it is a number nobody can compute in advance. Okay, but now all this we can compute. Okay, what is first you measure the noise from the detector. What is the noise? The usual noise you see are things like that. But because this is the noise NS of f, okay. This is saying the noise is minimum around 150 hertz or something like that. And then the noise increases at low frequencies and increases at high frequency. Here, what you want is to take this noise, multiply it by f, so it's dimensionless, and take the inverse. When you do that, the noise is something like that, which is saying now the maximum is the highest sensitivity, okay? And yes, so this is this thing, the 1 over, sorry, this is HN, am I correct here? It's 1 over HN square, yes. So it's 1 over HN square of F. And what is this? I just need to know V of F. But V of F is written here. It is F to the 1/3 with the mass. Because the mass now is giving the conversion between hertz that you measure in the detector, because 150 hertz is 150 hertz, okay? But the source is emitting things with a frequency which depends on the mass. So somewhere I need the mass to convert the two. But there is a universal shape in the sense that this thing is something, first it is the inverse power 1/3, and 1/3 is like zero, okay? So it is something which is very flat and which goes to zero at merger. So you have 1 over vf is this thing, which is saying that, but the merger frequency is the one I computed. It goes like 1 over m. So depending on the mass, I will, and my signal to noise ratio will be the product of this and this integrated. Okay, so the area. But this thing is a universal curve, f minus one-third. So if I incorporate the f minus one-third in this thing, I can modify this curve by multiplying by f to the minus one-third. So I have, again, a universal noise, which is what? It's something like that. And then if I do that, I will have, if I go f minus one-third to infinity, I will have something like that. But to cut it off here. So at the end, my signal-to-noise ratio is given by the yellow area, is the area under this curve, which I can compute numerically. But this area depends a lot of where is the merger frequency and depends on the factor in front. Okay, so now I can compute relative areas, the real values. But one thing that you have to keep in mind is that if I consider the coalescence of two neutron stars, the masses formerly up to merger, they will be of order of three solar mass. But remember the formula I had somewhere, although this does not really apply, but formerly the merger frequency and the LSO frequency, they now, if I take m equal three solar mass, I have 4,000 hertz, 4 kilohertz. But my peak sensitivity is around 150 hertz. So when I consider a neutron star, I will have a signal which extends to the kilohertz region, where actually my noise is very high, which is saying that what I see in the signal is mostly from the in spiral, because for neutron star, most of the signal will come when the two things are still farther apart and are in adiabatic in spiral. But for a binary black hole, we are going to show for 65 solar mass, the figure is approximately this one. That is to say, that's why I've drawn this one. This thing, as we will see, is, as I already said, is 187.4 hertz. This is the merger frequency. So the merger frequency and this maximum, actually, when you put numbers, is 56 hertz. That is to say, the signal is 50% of the signal is accumulated before merger up to something like the last stable orbit and beginning of the plunge. But after merger, we will show a better figure with slides after the break. But there is still a significant, like 40% of the signal to noise ratio, which is obtained after the merger. So it is indeed an excellent situation where, because of the mass of 65 solar mass, you are roughly around the most sensitive part of the detector, but you still need to know the signal from quite a few cycles before up to after merger to, if you want the full signal to noise ratio, which is in that case 24, 25. Okay? We have a break now and we'll go in 15 minutes with some slides. These are Einstein equations, and here, as we will discuss, this is both numerical relativity computation of the waveform and an EOB NR waveform tuned to numerical relativity. And as we will see, there are two curves superposed, and you cannot see.
I have already a question. When you use results from numerical relativity, is that the results from which group?
I will discuss now. Okay. Okay. So we go fast for this. So the good paper where Einstein really predicted things is 1918. He found two transverse traceless modes propagating at the velocity of light. Let's pay our tribute to Joe Weber, who as early as 1958, at a time where some theorists were confused about the reality of gravitational waves, also because they did not know the result of Madame Choquet-Bruhat, who had proven mathematically that there existed gravitational waves in a clear mathematical sense. Anyway, Joe Weber, because he had discussed with Marcel Riss, had understood the role of the Riemann tensor, the tidal Jacobi equation and things like that, and realized you could detect things, okay? Okay, I don't redo this thing. That was the lecture one. Just a mention again, many people say binary pulsar is an indirect proof of gravitational waves, but it's just because they do an indirect reasoning saying it loses energy and gravity. We have shown with Nathalie Deriel that a direct reasoning of the interaction of the equations of motion, including the retarded interaction between two neutron stars, contain damping effects, contain extra forces at V over C5 level that explain the observed P dot of binary pulsars. So it is a direct proof. Binary pulsars have proven that gravity propagates at the velocity of light and with the properties of Einstein's theory. So we don't need to go. So I have explained this morning all the work on the dynamics. Last time I had explained gravitational wave generation. I have explained this morning resummation techniques in the EUB formalism. As I said, the references are contained in the web page on gravitational waves on the IHES web page. Okay, now there are several detectors in the world. The ones that are functioning now, although maybe they have stopped for being updated, were the two LIGO detectors in Washington State and Louisiana. They are 4 kilometers by 4 kilometers interferometers. This is a 600 meters, which does not, in Germany, which does not contribute. The Virgo, if it had been online, would have seen the signal, but was not online at the time. But the Virgo team participated in the analysis of the data. This is the type of things over the years of the noise measured in detectors and how it went, the noise went down in a frequency. You see, this is around 150 hertz here. I have plotted the inverse effective noise there, so I don't need to go back to this thing. Okay, I already, so I said at a time where people in Cape Town group claim it is impossible to use ways of estimating what happens during the merger of two black holes. With Alessandra, we said, no, let's be bold, and we use this new method, and we predict this. 5 years later, a young postdoc from Canada, Franz Pretorius, was the first one to make numerical relativity work and did the first computation of the coalescence of two black holes. Although he had, as competitors, big groups with many people, he found this in his corner. After he found that, by modifying the way of writing, instead of using the type of hyperbolic, harmonically reduced equations that Yvonne Choquet proved the existence, the solution of the existence of, he added extra terms, constraint terms on the right-hand side to have better properties of evolution of the Einstein, relaxed Einstein equations. And then other groups soon, with Manuela Campanelli and others, and John Baker and others, they succeeded in computing the coalescence. So these are numerical relativity computation of the waveforms. As you can see, it looks like that. I must say that there are several countries in the world that are able to do numerical relativity calculations of coalescing black holes. Alas, France does not belong to this club, which was a hampering factor for us.
What kind of computer they need?
No, it's not a question of computer.
We have the computers.
Yes, we have the computers. But then you need people to... You need people to write the codes to... Okay?
You don't understand.
Let's not enter into this. This is a fact. This is a fact. Okay, so... the effective one-body formalism, which was initiated in 1999 and 2000.
Questions about this numerical?
Yeah, we will see more numerical relativity, better things. So now I want to insist on the point. I have explained here the basics of EUB, which is the way it started. Soon, it was extended to the 3PN level, which is this thing, where one found the necessity of adding this modification of the mass shell condition. Then I suggested how to extend it, because everything I've said, this was a question of Natalie. I have said two black holes, non-spinning black holes, okay? And then you have the effacement thing and thing like. When you have spinning black holes, you need to extend the EUB formalism. And the idea that I suggested in 2001 is to say, we will look for a deformation of a Kerr black hole instead of a Schwarzschild black hole with terms depending on nu that reproduce the Hamiltonian, where you add to these terms spin-dependent terms, okay?
This works for black holes only then?
Sorry?
This works for black holes only?
Yes, now I'm talking about black holes.
It's not chaos, I do.
Yes, I'm talking about black holes, yes. No, but for neutron stars, actually, with the amount of spin, the Kerr is enough. Yeah, you don't care about this thing. These are spin. The first generalization of the waveform I had shown for the non-spinning case was done for the spinning case in this paper with Yanbei Chen and Alessandra, which, due to the fact that Yanbei Chen kept the proofs for nearly 1 year, was published after the numerical relativity breakthrough, though it was on the archive 6 months before and things like that. So this was done before numerical relativity. After numerical relativity waveform came along, then one realized, and even before that, because there is a paper of 2002 with the then existing numerical relativity group in France around Philippe Grand-Clément and Eric Gourgoulon, where we propose the philosophy of saying, once there will be numerical relativity data, you can consider that there is a flexibility in the effective one-body formalism. The effective one-body formalism, remember, depended on parameters A1, A2, A3, A5 that appear in the A potential, and B1, B2, B3 that appear in the B potential. As you notice, the notation is tuned to the thing. At the time, we did not know the coefficient A5. And then the idea was suggested, let's put an unknown coefficient A5 and let's find, by comparison to numerical relativity data, what is the best value of the coefficient A5 that will reproduce the numerical relativity data. That is to say, you use the framework, analytical framework of EOB, and then the extra parameters that you have not yet computed, you determine by comparison with numerical relativity data. Okay. And this philosophy was developed in two groups, in the group of Alessandra Buonanno in the States and with Alessandro Naga and me here at IHES in the years starting 07, etc. We also use comparison with a small mass ratio simulation, and I will explain that some, yes, and a new idea for resumming the waveform, which actually is very important for the accuracy of DOB, was invented here. This is the factorized waveform that I will show briefly later. Let me also mention, in case I don't have the time to come back to it, that when discussing neutron star coalescence, merger, actually, why I said before, the tidal effects are very small, 5 pn. They are 5 pn, but they contain the radius to the 5. And for a neutron star, the radius is not equal to 2 gm squared, but there is a factor which is significant, which to the power 5 makes it actually not negligible. So you need to include, and they are quite important, tidal interaction of neutron stars and compute them to relativistic accuracy. And that we have done with Donato Bini, with many people. Here, let me show you, so reminding you the basic philosophy of EOB. During the in-spiral thing, you have two point masses, orbiting point masses with resum dynamics. You define a merger time within the formalism. And then you say that after that, the signal is a sum of a certain number of quasi-normal modes, which are the ringing modes of a deformed black hole. And the point I want to say is that here you have two curves, you see. You have a red curve and you have a black curve. And one of the two, the black curve, this one, is numerical relativity, and the red curve is EOB NR, which means now not the pure analytical EOB, but EOB tuning parameters by what I said. And as you can see, there is an exquisite agreement, including for the amplitude and especially the phase, except for this small glitch here. But there. So it shows that EOBNR is a way to compute things semi-analytically, to have an analytical framework, and you just integrate on a computer to get this. Now, here goes the events. So on 14 September 2015, the two LIGO detectors at Hanford, Washington State, and Livingston, Louisiana State, they found signals. These signals are already filtered in the sense that if you had the broadband noise, you know, the full noise, you would not see the signal, okay? But here, there is a minimal filtering in the sense they filter frequency between 35 hertz and I forgot, like 350 hertz, something like that. So you put, you know, a high frequency filter and a low frequency filter, and now you have a limited bandwidth for noise. And with this limited bandwidth, here you see the noise. Here it's noise. But here you start seeing on top of the noise, there is something which looks like this thing, which was from 2000. And if you use the modern improved either pure numerical relativity or EOB-NR, which means EOB improved with numerical relativity, for the mass we are talking about, you have this thing, okay? And why am I showing that? Because there are several levels of filtering. What happens is, because you need to go fast. When LIGO, you need to have filters that in a few milliseconds can tell something happened, some glitch in the detector, to be able to tell observers in X-ray astronomy, gamma ray astronomy, turn or look if there is something in the sky going on. So there are several layers of filters. Very fast one that use decomposing in bins the frequency at each moment and seeing essentially what happens is here you see in a frequency band of these frequencies there is more noise. Okay, I mean there is more signal. So you do this saying, ah, there is probably something going on. Then you use a second level of filter saying, okay, let's try to feed that to some wavelet type templates where the frequency is chirping to be able to say, ah, I have indeed a chirp. And then the level where you do the full Wiener filtering, which is to say, what I want to do is what I have explained before. I take the noisy signal and I do this convolution weighted by the inverse noise with the Fourier transform of this. But this computed for various values of M1 and M2 and also spins up to the moment where, as I explained before, the scalar product between the two shows a peak for some values of the masses. And then you say, ah, we have seen something because the signal to noise ratio is 25 after much filtering. And the maximum of the signal-to-noise ratio happens for masses equal to 65 total solar mass, etc. At this stage, in order not to come back to it, I should say that actually the frequencies you see here, we are talking about events which are a billion light years away, more or less, and therefore the cosmological redshift is not negligible. It is like 9%, which is saying that you redshift. So the frequencies are redshifted, the times are enlarged, things like that. So the frequency you see in the detector has to be now blue shifted if you want to say what is the frequency in the source, okay? And if you extract like the chirp mass directly, the chirp mass you get is not the real chirp mass, it is redshifted by a factor 1 plus z. And then you need to know more analysis to extract the distance and the redshift in order to compute the mass in the detector.
But the distance is very badly known, so the mass...
Yes, so there is the... Yeah, it adds to the uncertainty, but finally, not so much, okay? The fact that it's 1.085 or 1.09, it's a relatively small effect, okay? It's a 9% or 8.5%. You have uncertainties which are larger than that, so it adds a little bit, but it's not. Now, let's discuss, that's why I introduced this signal-to-noise ratio. So here I have the function that I was discussing here, which is, it's the, this is the integrant. So remember, I said the square of the signal-to-noise ratio of match filtering is an integral over logarithmic frequency. This axis is the log of the frequency, okay? So I want now to represent a curve such that the area below this curve is equal to the signal-to-noise ratio square, okay? And this is this curve. This curve is what I was showing here, except that here there is more information put in because the noise of the detector would not have this bump here. But when I said that the lowest approximation of... Because here I computed using the quadrupole formula, what was the signal, okay? After multiplying V4 divided by V5 was 1 over V. But actually, this 1 over V is during the in spiral. During merger, a glitch happens. There is something which happens, and therefore this curve is modified. It is something like that, and then it has that, and also the post merger is a more smooth decay. Okay, so this bump, when you multiply by the noise, yes, this is it. Yeah, you see, this is indeed okay. Now this is A of F. So this thing, which not multiply by things, should be f to the minus 7/6 anyway in the in-spiral. So it's a straight line in a log-log plot, but you have this extra thing due to the merger, which happens here. Here, with Alessandro, we worked this out, computing from EUB and the noise of LIGO for 65 total solar mass. What is so? This is the integrand, logarithmic integrand for the signal-to-noise ratio. So the area under this is the total signal-to-noise ratio square, which is 25 square. Okay, so that's why it's large here. You see, there are 800, and here in logarithmic you have one unit and one unit here. Okay, so you have 25 square is should be consistent with this area. Now we have plotted here various curves. Here there is a 35 Hertz curve, which actually should have been redshifted, but it's not important for this, which is just to show that what they showed in the plot before was obtained by filtering out everything above here and everything above there. So, but still, you were seeing something because you keep most of the signal there. But I discussed that from the theoretical point of view, there is the two things go around. Then they reach a moment where they have the last stable circular orbit that you cross smoothly without noticing something happens, but still it gives a marker. It's definitely the end of the in-spiral, okay? In the sense that before that, you plunge, so you cannot call it, although it's a quasi-in-spiral. And as you see, it is here, which is saying that actually most of the signal-to-noise ratio square comes from the in-spiral. I had a plot somewhere saying it comes before the last stable orbit, but still, a lot of the signal is also after the last stable orbit. Now, where is merger in the EOB sense? Merger is this red thing. It is here. And in their paper, they say, let's introduce a transition frequency, which is now not defined in any physical way. They say we put 132 Hertz, just to say it's some part of the in-spiral. Actually, what I think they did is they tried to look something to be able to say that after this frequency is during the plunge and before the merger, that you still have enough signal-to-noise ratio to be able to say that you see something around merger separately from the in-spiral, so that you can test that GR is okay during the in-spiral, and GR, general relativity, with the same masses is also valid during merger and ring down put together. Okay, so it's a choice. If you really ask what is the amount of signal-to-noise ratio after merger, you see it is this area compared to all this. So this is showing that the signal-to-noise ratio square after merger is not negligible. I mean, it's not nothing, this area, but it is small compared, we did not compute numbers, but 85% of the signal-to-noise ratio square is before merger. And then after merger, you don't have much signal-to-noise ratio square. That's why they cannot claim, it's a separate statement. One can claim that this thing is consistent with the same masses in general relativity as this part, which is a good test of general relativity. It's not absolute clear proof that the quasi-normal modes are there, because you cannot extract really with accuracy the quasi-normal modes, or at least the first quasi-normal modes. Now, another picture they show is this whitened signal, which also they use intelligent tricks, which is that the signal is this gray thing here. Okay, if the gray thing was put in black, you would see the signal is very noisy. But here, to help you, you guide the eye by putting the theoretical predictions, from one from EOB and one from a combination of wavelets. And whitening means what? whitenings, it's an idea introduced by Wiener, is that if you have colored noise, there exists a linear transformation in Hilbert space which transform color noise in white noise. And this transformation in Fourier space is a Fourier transform. You divide by the square root of Sn, the noise, spectral density. You go back to the time domain. This is a Hilbert type transform. It's a, how is it called? It's a kernel, okay? T minus T prime, okay? Which is defined by the inverse square root of the noise. But the property is when you apply this to the full signal, noise plus signal, it changes the noise which is correlated in time in a noise which is uncorrelated in time and therefore which, in a sense, is adding noise at each time, you know, separately. So it makes it clearer what is the noise. But it affects the signal because now the signal is like, you know, filtered by the noise, okay? So you see not the real signal, but what your noise glasses see, okay? That's why this shape is not the same shape as before. But still, it shows, again, the fact that you see the merger is around here, the fact that you see this and that the noise, you see the noise here is comparable to the signal here. But here it is smaller, so at least for the first ringing down, you see it. Okay, so you have this. Now, something surprising is for years, people said, okay, binary black holes, this means 10 solar mass, or maybe 15, 15. Why did people say that? All the galactic in the Milky Way, our galaxy, all the black holes have masses between 4 and 14 or 15 solar mass, okay? You don't know masses bigger than this. Even the largest extragalactic evidence for stellar mass black hole gives something like 15 solar masses. One did not know in the universe, in the sense of X-ray sources, systems with 30 solar mass black holes. But Belchinsky and his collaborators in 2010 had predicted from the data of the Sloan survey that we know that half of the galaxies in the Sloan survey have low metallicity, which means they don't have polluting material that we are made of, but mainly hydrogen and helium. And they predicted that this changed a lot the history of formation of black holes and binary black holes. And they said, first, the black holes will be more massive. So between 30 and solar, so in galaxies like that, the black holes will be between 30 and 80. And they predicted also that it increases the number of such binary now black holes by big factors, 1,000, 10,000. And therefore, in 2010, they predicted that as soon as LIGO, Virgo will have a semi-advanced thing, the first signal they should see should be from 30-30 binary black hole, which was a nice prediction, okay? Because this is what has been seen.
So is there the explanation why one doesn't see those black holes in X-ray, just because they are far away, I guess? Or?
Yes. Okay, now, yes, so that I have already discussed. But I want to go to other things. By the way, this is the full Hamiltonian. The Hamiltonian I've written here was in the center of mass. This is the 2pn and 3pn Hamiltonians not in the center of mass. So many more terms, okay? I never showed the explicit formulas. As I said, the Blanchet Damour higher formalism, which had been pushed to great extremes by Blanchet and higher, have computed, for instance, the quadrupolar mode of the gravitational wave emitted by a circular binary to, here it should be, yeah, there is the term which is known here. This is the 3pn level and this is the 3.5pn level. So these are the type of things that I said they are necessary, this is very important, but if you apply them bluntly and put that on the right-hand side, this is not good because this term is larger than the first term. So you need a way to resum them. And now let me explain some of the resummation because I quickly mentioned the EUB formalism, which has these equations of motion together with, yeah, one does not see much, but this is a radiation reaction thing. One important thing is to factorize the waveform. This is something, an idea we introduced with Alessandro Nagar, and then we developed with Bala Ayer and Alessandro. And the idea is there is that when you look at these formulas, one has put together several effects, because you expand in powers of V over C and you put everything at some order. But you can come back to the physics behind that and say, actually, there are physics where you can resum to all orders, like in QFT, where you can resum all leading logs, okay, by solving actually a Coulomb wave equation, because you find that there are tail effects due to the propagation of the gravitational waves in the curved spacetime. And if you solve exactly this thing, and actually using a Coulomb wave function, you can sum the terms which are due to the Coulomb M over R tail. Exactly, it's some gamma function. And then you can factorize this. And after that, you do a second factorization, which is what I had explained before, which is this idea that we had introduced with Ayer and Satya Prakash, that the reason why the radius of convergence of this thing is bad is that there is a singularity somewhere if you were considering a circular orbit as an exact mathematical function. Why it goes on circular orbit, you are going to use it in the inspiral region, but analytically you can say the formula is for a circular orbit down to the level where they exist circular orbits. And the level where they exist circular orbits is beyond the last stable circular orbit, the light ring, because this is the last unstable circular orbit. But if you consider this mathematical formula, you realize that at the light ring, there will be a singularity. And probably this is the first singularity in the complex plane, and therefore it defines the radius of convergence, and it works. That is to say, if you estimate the radius of convergence, you see that it works with the growth of the coefficient. So what do? You factorize it, as I explained for Padé. If you factorize the first singularity, it won't be there, the singularity. And therefore, this is what is done in this factorized waveform, which maybe is shown later. So this I've explained for the EUB. I don't need to re-explain that. Yes. So here, there are the various factorization. Let me enter a little bit in the details. There is an infinite sum of logarithm that you can resum by this function, which contain, you see, an exponential, it's like the Coulomb phase, exponential of 2 ik log. So it takes away a lot of bad terms. Then there is the source, effective source. You use the effective one-body formalism to factorize what would be infinite if you were going up to the light ring. And then it improves the convergence of the rest. After you have the rest, you do a last resummation, which is you write it as the elf power of another post-Newtonian series. And now the post-Newtonian series, which is the elf root, looks better than before. Okay? And then this way, this is the way where so at the end, the type of formula you use in UB is this type of things. You write H as the product of various factors. Most of the factors are analytically computed and resummed. But when we use this initially with Alessandro to compare to numerical relativity data, we found that these formulas were very good up to the late inspiral and beginning of the plunge. But at merger, there was like a 15% difference. Okay, and then we said, okay, it's clear there is a 15% difference, but we are working with circular orbits here. There are effects which are non-circular. So let's add them. We know analytically how they should be. They should be 1 plus the momentum, the radial momentum square, something like that, which is 0 for the circular case. And the coefficient you cannot compute analytically, so you compute it numerically by comparison with numerical data. And these are the NQC. So here, evidently, you start using information from numerical relativity beyond analytical thing, but grafted on something which is mainly analytical. This is these NQC factors which allow to be so good up to merger. Okay, this was an example of the new resummation when we tested it. which was here purely analytical, was coinciding with numerical data for the test particle limit, for instance. So this was a check that. Now, the modern, actually, we include, in fact, there is also a log, which is, we have to update this transparency. This coefficient A5, which for many years was unknown, is a 4PN coefficient. And thanks to recent work with Donato Bini, we could analytically compute it. And I should say that here we have, by the way, an expert in the room, Abhay Shah, on another type of technique that we have used to improve DOB, which is called gravitational self-force technique, which I will mention a little bit better, which is a different way of using perturbation theory around black hole to compute terms linear in nu. So this term actually is known, and there is a log part. And now, but this term, in that case, is also known, but you prefer to say, I don't know it. I write the A function as a function of this parameter. I padde it. And now I tune the parameter A6 to numerical relativity data. Instead of including an infinite series, you include just the next term. Then you compute the padde. You tune to numerical relativity data. And this gives you an effective value of A6, which is maybe not written here in the best way. And this is the way you can get numerical EOBNR waveform. Now, as I said, the group of Alessandra Buonanno has got a different version of EOB, which used many of the improvements we have introduced here, and which was tuned to American numerical relativity data, because we did not have access for many years because of what I said to American numerical relativity data. Let me not spend time on this. Yes, let me give other aspects of EOB. Because EOB was conceived to compute numerical relativity waveforms for the coalescence of two black holes. But it can do more, because this is a way of transforming a badly defined post-Newton expanded dynamics for two bodies in something that can describe the interaction of two comparable mass black holes in the strong field condition. And in particular, here we could compare various EOB predictions to gauge invariant quantities in binary black hole dynamics. Like when you have a system of two black holes and you compute it numerically, the two black holes go around, they emit gravitational waves at infinity, so they lose energy and angular momentum. But numerically, you can compute the losses of energy and angular momentum. And therefore, it gives an estimate of what is the remaining energy and remaining angular momentum of two black holes when they are close by subtracting from the Arnovitz-Deser-Meissner ADM mass and angular momentum the losses to gravitational waves. So this way, you can compute the curve giving, along numerical relativity, the energy. This is the energy. Now it is a binding energy divided by mu, so it's a dimensionless thing, okay? Versus angular momentum divided also to make it dimensionless. And here, you have numerical data which are in black, okay? And you have the EOB analytical data which are in red, and you have post-Newtonian, because also the relation between energy and angular momentum, actually we had computed it at 3PN with Yarnowski and Schaeffer, it's a formula you can compute, and therefore on the same plot you can compute post-Newtonian and EOB and numerical relativity. And as you can see, numerical relativity starts here, emits some so-called junk radiation, and then goes along this curve, which is the EOB analytical thing. And this is merger, okay? So up to merger, this plot shows that the description of dynamics of EOB, energy versus, which is a gauge invariant thing. I have no coordinates here. It's purely gauge invariant. There is a very nice agreement, okay? Alexandre Letiec and others, Barak, others, there is Alessandra also in this paper, have also compared EOB and other things to periastron precession of two black holes. Although this is less clear what is gauge invariant there, because they do that in a coordinate and it's not completely clear. But and they were also in a regime which was not very close to merger. But still, EOB is here and numerical data are here. So there is, again, a very good agreement for this periastron precession in the comparable mass case. Now, I did not have the time to discuss, this is an outdated thing. The extension, as I said, the extension of UB to spin was initiated here in 2001, and then was pursued with me, Jaworski, and Schaefer, and then with Alessandra Buonanno and other people like Enrico Barraus and others, Racine. And recently we have a new thing which is still under development with Alessandro. I just want to show that for the neutron star case, although this is not, yes, for the neutron star case, let me mention this. I said there was this idea that two black holes can be replaced by two point masses, okay? But as I said, a neutron star has a Love number. And now, as I had computed long ago, this Love number has an effect which is equivalent to having a quadrupolar interaction between the tidal thing and the tidal quadrupole deformation. If you express it in effective field theory language, as emphasized by Goldberger and Rothstein, this means that you must add a term to the effective action, which is of this type. So now, instead of a point mass, you add to the point mass a structure, which is this tensor square contracted. It's the Riemann tensor contracted. It's the electric tensor square, which is an extra term. Okay? And when you do this, you can augment the EUB interaction by this tidal interaction, and it changes the A potential. The A potential is the most important because it's the interaction energy. Okay? So it adds to the black hole thing, a tidal thing, which at lowest order, it's 1 over R6. 1 over R6 is just the Newtonian interaction of two quadrupoles, of an induced quadrupole. Okay? But you need, there are relativistic corrections that have been computed by several people. In particular, this second order term was computed by Donato Bini, myself, and Guillaume Fay. And these are important because these terms are not small, actually. They play an important role. And gravitational self-force, yes. Another thing that I want to mention is that effective one-body theory can also discuss the interaction of black holes on hyperbolic trajectories. Up to now, I have been discussing the motion of two black holes on quasi-circular up to merger. But you can do like in S-matrix theory, say I have two black holes, I shoot them against each other, then they go around each other, and then they can escape at infinity. Okay, it's S-matrix, and in S-matrix theory, you have a gauge invariant. The gauge invariant is the scattering angle as a function of energy and angular momentum. And therefore, you can compare the predictions from EOB for what is the scattering angle as a function of energy and angular momentum with numerical relativity, because you can, in numerical relativity, although it is, in a sense, more tricky than the numerical relativity of two black holes going around and merging, you can do that. And this we have done in a paper with Gersilena, Jan Hinder, Seth Hopper, Alessandro, and Luciano Rezzola in 2014. And we studied the scattering. So here you have the trajectories of the two black holes. And you see you go to very large scattering angle. Here the scattering angle is the angle between the initial thing and the final thing. Okay. But when you go here, you go more than pi, okay? You go back from where you come. And in these things, this is the impact parameter at infinity. But when you ask what is the closest distance of approach of the two black holes, you find it's 3m. So it means here you are using really strong field scattering. You know, the two black holes, they nearly merge, but because they go a little, not very fast actually, you can still extract some information. Actually, what you do is you compare, because here you are probing the effective potential near the top of the barrier, of the centrifugal barrier. If you make them, if the impact parameter is reduced a little bit more than this, the two things merge, and then they don't come out. So you have to stop at some level. And here there is a comparison of this gauge invariant function, chi in degrees versus angular momentum. at fixed energy, you change the angular momentum, which means you change the impact parameter. The numerical data are here. These are post-Newtonian predictions, like at 1pn, 2pn, 3pn, which are good in the region of large impact parameter, but they lose validity when they get closer. Why the EOB keeps being good, except really at the last thing where you start seeing that probably you should improve the thing. Let me, so as I said, two groups developed EOB NR versions of EOB. The group of Alessandra Bonanno with those last year's work by Andrea Tarracchini. And here in this plot, I have compared what is the final result of years of work on the EOB description of the dynamics of two black holes. As I said, most of the dynamical information in these things is summarized in this A function, because the A function is the interaction energy for circular binaries, okay? The B function is linked to non-circular binaries. For the most interesting event, you are mostly interested in the A function, okay? Here I have plotted various A function. In the Schwarzschild limit, this A function is 1 minus 2m over r, so it is this thing. And as I said, when you include all the complicated 4pn, finally, it amounts to moving this thing up, which was the analytic prediction. Remember, all the terms were positive, so they were making gravity less attractive, okay? And here I have compared two curves. This curve, which comes from a different way of of representing the A function by factoring an horizon. The blue thing is from Tarracchini, Buonanno et al. And the red thing is our PADE-based thing. And as you can see, these two things have been given to NR data. That's why it's not very surprising that merger happens here. So this function is not used beyond this. So here you see that the two curves are very close. So when you use analytical information plus numerical relativity, indeed you converge to the same EOB description. This is what this plot is saying. By contrast, and in a sense, this corrects what I had said when I had said the difference between neutron stars and black holes is linked to this Love number K2, which is a 5pn term. And in 1982, 5pn was beyond the horizons, so we were fighting with 2pn, so 5pn was zero. Okay. Now here, when you include this 5pn correction, is the tidal interaction. So it modifies the A function by adding a term, but now this term is negative. You see, this is the Schwarzschild A function, 1 minus 2 over r. If you add the effect of the new deformation, which means the nonlinear gravity of two black holes, you have something which is less attractive. It pushes the potential up, so instead of minus 1 over r, which is attractive, you have minus 1 over r plus something repulsive. But if you take into account the tidal effects, you add to the attraction because the two things suck each other, okay, by the tidal deformation. and therefore, you get this thing. Although it looks very dramatic here because we have resummed things in a certain way, actually, the merger of the two neutron stars happens here. So in this region, the effect is small, okay? It's small, but it is on the other side. That is to say, finally, the attraction due to tidal deformation of the two neutron stars is more important than the nonlinear effect due to gravity, but you need both, because earlier in the in-spiral, the gravity thing are more important, okay?
And in all cases, you have the case where the two neutron stars coalesce into a black hole, or it doesn't matter?
What happens at the merger, okay, first it depends on the mass ratio of the two things, because if one is larger than the other one, you can tidally disrupt one and things like that. If they are, at some point when they are of the same mass, they form a disk, complicated objects, which will have a bar mode type thing. And then if you are beyond, if 1.5, if your equation of state is such that, like Remo Ruffini and Rhodes said, free solar mass is a black hole, then at the end it will create a black hole. But in the meantime, you will have a lot of matter going around, emitting also gamma rays and things like that, probably. So it gets beyond what analytical relativity can do. In the black hole case, EOB can predict the signal from minus infinity to plus infinity. For the binary neutron star, one is happy if you predict things up to merger.
Independently of the masses of the black holes, which I can observe, the very shape of the ringing modes shows that it's a black hole and not the merger of the neutron star.
No, but the masses, you cannot have neutron star with 30 solar masses, okay.
Independently of the masses, the shape.
Yes, the shape, except that you could invent, dark neutron stars extremely close. I mean, if you have boson stars, which radius, okay. It's not a proof, okay. This is the good thing. I said there is a signal-to-noise ratio, okay? Now, I said there is an optimal filter, that is to say. You want to approximate the real signal by some analytical signal. Now, the measure of how good you are is the Wiener scalar product, because as we said, at the end, the maximum information you can extract is obtained by filtering the thing by your filter. And then if your filter is a perfect representation of the signal, lost in the noise, your signal to noise ratio will be HH, the scalar product square of H. If your filter is H prime, slightly different from H, your maximum signal-to-noise ratio will be smaller than HH by the cosine of the two vectors H and H prime in Hilbert space, because we are in a Hilbert space, we have a scalar product, and two vectors, there is a Cauchy-Schwarz-Bukowski inequality or whatever, which says that if I have two vectors, the product of two vectors is their length times a cosine smaller than one, okay? Because I have a positive definite thing. So you always lose in signal-to-noise ratio. Now, the loss which is called the faithfulness, is the scalar product normalized of two things. If it is equal to one, it means the signal to use is equal to the exact thing. If it is smaller than one, it means you lose something. And this loss means you can lose some events, and you want F to be as closer to one. In other words, you compute the unfaithfulness of your template, which is one minus the cosine of the two vectors in Hilbert space, and you want this one minus F to be small. And now this is a representation, it's a comparison of the faithfulness of EOB and R in the version we developed recently for black holes. And now you see, I have not explained how we discuss really spinning black holes. But this is the spin parameters of the black holes, 994 in that case. So this means they are nearly extreme spinning. And here, minus 95. So they are extremely spinning, but spinning in the other thing. So here, you are really using, strong general relativity, EOB extended with spin black holes, and you compare how good you are compared to full numerical relativity. Okay? And this mark is 10 minus 2. That is saying all those things are better than 99%. But actually, you see that most of them are around 3 10 minus 4. So it means you are good to 99.99%. Okay? And this is also a histogram, which is the maximum unfaithfulness. And you see the median value of the unfaithfulness is around here. It's so this is 10 minus 3. So anyway, this is better than what is needed for several years. So this is saying that this analytical EOB formalism for spinning black holes with non-perturbative information used to tune some parameters allows to have a very good representation of the full numerical relativity signal. I should say, to be complete, that I said that the analysis of the gravitational wave events, I said they use several filters, coarse filters, and at the end they use EOB and R filters. Actually, at the end they use two types of high accuracy filters, the EOB NR filters in a bank of templates built by Alessandra Bonanno and her group using the EOB theory. And they also used, because there is a slight problem that for years we said it's not important and computers will be fast enough, but apparently they are not fast enough, is that the EOB equations of motion, I wrote them for you. You can write on the blackboard, okay, these equations. But in the right-hand side, they have a radiation reaction force, which contains gamma function, which contains, you know, logarithm. All this, and you cannot solve this full dynamics by hand, okay? You need to solve by solving ODEs. And solving by ODEs when the right-hand side is a little bit complicated takes a little bit of time, okay? It takes, what, 30 seconds, something like that. In numerical relativity, it takes 1 month to compute one waveform. So the great advantage of having analytical representation of waveform is that you can compute many, many templates, 10,000 templates, analytically. But if each template takes 30 seconds, even the analytical one, and if you want to compute millions of templates, this is too long, this thing. And the reason why they want to compute millions of templates is they want to do a Bayesian analysis. That is to say, you want to put Bayesian factor, probability factors, of that you measure this and this quantity. And to do this, you need to estimate probability distribution function in parameter space from computing many, many things in the Bayesian analysis. And if something takes 30 seconds, it's too long. So you can go to a second stage, which has been performed, in particular by people like Michael Purer and Kahn and Hanam, no, and others. So there are recent papers on this, where you take the EOB NR things, and then you look at them and you represent them in analytical form, effectively. That is to say, you decompose the phase and the frequency in the Fourier domain, and you say, okay, I can fit them to something else. So you fit something which was fitted to NR and a thing like that. And then it gives something which is now completely analytical and which now takes less than a millisecond to compute for each template because it's an explicit Fourier domain thing. And this you can do Bayesian analysis with millions of templates. So I guess that's the end, yes. So the conclusion is that because I did not say that. And I did not show, I had other transparencies, but they are somewhere else, showing how gravitational self-force analysis, black hole perturbation theory, allows to extract parameters in EOB. But this is like more advanced topic. Recent breakthrough, yeah, they are not so recent now. So the main point I wanted to convey is that you cannot use it is wrong to say that you use numerical relativity to predict things. Okay, you need analytical methods. You need PN theory to have a basis of analytical thing. You need resum PN theory in EOB and EOB NR form, which allows to predict many things. You need more layers. You need also other filters. So there is a lot going in the data analysis of the data, but somewhere in the middle of that, the fact that this EOB formalism exists and that there is a complementarity between numerical relativity of EOB, here it was written, is likely to be essential, but has been essential to compute things, because this has been done now, and EOB was part of the game. Okay, thank you for your attention.